Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our service this morning. If you're new or visitor, we're just really glad that you're here this morning. We pray that you are blessed and that you feel welcome. There are connection cards in the back if you go to like the little counter in the foyer. There's also a gift for our visitors, but we would love to have you fill this out just to get to know you better and how we can serve you in some fashion. There is one announcement this morning. We have a quarterly prayer meeting, or I think it's called SEEK. Yeah, that's right. It's 6:30 to 7:30 here at the church. Just a chance for us to get together to seek the Lord, seek his will for our congregation, and to invite him into our presence to all that we do. So I just encourage you to attend that this evening. I'd like to read from Psalm 8, just to get us quiet and start to enter into the presence of God. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? You have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. As you reflect back on this past week, what are some ways that you've seen God's majesty? I was thinking about that. I was driving down the road yesterday, and I was just looking at the explosion of growth, all the greenery, and new life. And I think at least from this passage, one of the evidences of God's majesty is God's creation, his creative ability. And, you know, you can really tell a lot about a person by what they create, by what they make, right? You know, you can tell if someone is skillful by looking at their creation, how skilled they are, how competent they are. You can tell, you know, if somebody is lazy at heart, that will often show in what they make in their construction or their creative product. And our question this morning, our catechism question that we're reading through, is really related to that. It says this. It says, did God create us unable to keep his law? And so it's really a question about God's creation. It's a question about God's character. You know, was he somehow incompetent in creating us? Did he create us with flaws, with deficiencies? Did we need to sort of be returned? And that's really the heart of this question is, how did God create us, and did he create us unable to keep his law? And I was thinking about that question, and I would answer that question a little bit before we get into the written answer, is I would caution us to think about this question from a biblical standpoint. You know, if you think about God's original design, how God originally created us, he did not create us to live by law. You know, God didn't create you, he didn't create me primarily to live by rules. And if you think about that in your own life, you'll know that that's very just crushing if you try to live by a standard of laws of do this and don't do that. And, you know, what you were created, how you were created primarily was to be led by God, to be led by him. You know, to trust him, to trust his character. And really it was the violation of that trusting relationship that eventually necessitated God giving us the law. And so, you know, the Christian life, if we think about the Christian life, the Christian life is primarily not, you know, primarily of do this, don't do that. It's really a restoration of life as it was intended to be. You know, if you think about a lot of just scriptures, it says the Lord is my shepherd, you know, he leads me. You think about Galatians, it says that we're called to walk by the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit of God. And we think about Romans 8, where it says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And so, if you're in Christ, if you're led by him, that's really what life is originally intended to be led by God, and not to be led by rules, by standards, by laws. And so I'm going to read the question. Let's read the answer together. It says this, did God create us unable to keep his law? And the answer to that is no, but because of the disobedience of our first parents, Adam and Eve, all of creation is falling. We are all born in sin and guilt and corrupt in our nature and unable to keep God's law. And let's read, I think it's going to be up there. Yep, from Romans 5:12. Let's read that together as well. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. And I thought, as our call to worship, it'd be kind of a shame to stop there at Romans 5:12. There's always a but in the New Testament. And so if we read a little bit further, it says this. But, so we talked about sin, we talked about our fallen nature. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through the one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And so that's really our celebration this morning, is that we've been set free from the bondage of sin through the blood and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads in prayer. And before we do that, I'm going to just take a few minutes of a few moments of silence just to quiet yourself, to think about what God has done for you this week, and also just to enter into his presence and to prepare to worship him. So let's bow our heads and pray. O Lord, our Lord, truly how majestic is your name. All of creation attests to that. As we think of spring, we think of new life, we think of the spring rains. We can just see the earth just bursting forth with life. And that is a testament to your creative ability, to your awesome power, to your creativity. And so we worship you. We thank you, Lord, that we are creatures, that we can look to you as our creator, that you promise to lead us, to guide us, that you have given us your law, Lord, because of our sinful, fallen nature, and it points to your holiness. But we just thank you, Lord, that through the blood of Jesus Christ that we've been set free, that we can worship you this morning, that we can celebrate that. And I pray for all of us as we think about worship, Lord, as we think about seeking you, that we would be led by your Spirit, that you would be in charge here this morning, that we would be just followers, that we'd be receptive, that we would be listeners, that we would have open hearts, open ears, open minds to what you have for us, that we would receive that. And so we just pray that now over the service, I pray for each one here that you bless them. I pray that you just give us humility to always just stand before your presence and to receive and to worship you. And so we love you. We do pray, Lord, that you come quickly. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Worthy is the Lamb. to see the dawn of the darkest day. Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten men, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross.
Oh, to see the pain.
To see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin. Every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. This the became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross.
Now the daylight flees.
Now the daylight flees. Now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. A curtain torn in two, dead I raised to life, finished the victory cry. This the power of the cross.
Just linger here for a moment in the presence of the Lord as we seek to praise Him with our words, with our songs, with the meditation of our heart. Psalm 5 says, "But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy." And one of the great privileges and opportunities of Christian worship is not only singing to God and praising Him, but also speaking the truth of God to one another. Christian worship is encouraging one another, challenging one another, urging one another to believe and to trust in the promises that God has made and all that He is for us. So I want to invite you, just where you are, just to finish this phrase. It says, "Let all who take refuge in you rejoice." And I just invite you to speak out loudly so others can hear. Lord, I take refuge in you in. And whatever it is that you take refuge in God's greatness and His goodness, you speak that to the Lord and to your brothers and sisters. Lord, I take refuge in you in. And then you complete that sentence. Would you lift your praises to Him?
In your humility,
in your presence,
and
in your patience,
Lord, we take refuge in you. We just sang that, oh, to see our names written on your hands. We stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, Lord, we come to you this morning and we take refuge in all that you are for us. We thank you. We bless your holy name. We ask as we continue in our time of worship and song, Lord, that you would be honored and glorified and that your people's hearts would be lifted up in the presence of Jesus, who is everything for us. Let us rejoice in him.
Sing, I stand in awe. Sing, you are beautiful.
You are beautiful beyond description. Too marvelous for words. Too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depths of your love? You are beautiful beyond description. Majesty enthroned above, and I stand in all of you, and I stand in all of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand. Oh. wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. But who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your majesty enthroned above? And I stand in all of you, Lord. I stand in all of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand.
I stand
in all of you, Lord. I stand in all of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand in all of you.
Lord, we do this morning stand in all of you, Lord, in all of your power, Lord, and of your majesty, your goodness. God, we thank you for your love, Lord, in our lives. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness always, God. Lord, we love you. Thank you for all this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age." May God bless the hearing of his word.
I want to invite our kids to stand who are headed off to their kids in praise. I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you guys. Our Father in heaven, we want to pray for our children who, Lord, are precious in your sight and whom you desire them to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we would pray for them this morning that you would teach them your way as they go to their class. We ask, Lord, that their hearts would be sensitive and tender to your voice. We ask, Lord, for our teachers, that you would bless them and strengthen them as they bring the word of life to these young ones. And for us, Lord, in this room, that you would give us great wisdom, that you would help us to hear your word and to be ones whose ears are open, eyes open to see, hearts to respond in faith, trust, and obedience. Lord, how we need you. We ask that you would come in your fullness and the power of your Spirit. We ask, Lord, that you would teach us. We pray that you would help us to respond as is befitting to your word. May we receive your word for what it is, the very words of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want to invite you to have your Bibles open to Matthew chapter 28. Hopefully, quite a number of our folks are off at district youth retreat. We had some 30 or 30 plus people who are away. They'll be coming back later this afternoon, and we're delighted to hear the stories of God's goodness for them. I'm going to share one of those with you in just a second. I hope that you've taken time to pick up one of these study guides for our series, our sermon series. There's a few left on the table there in the foyer. They will help you to be able to study a little bit of the passage of Scripture each week prior to coming here. Remember, I've said this before, I'll say it again. We have a kind of very simple plan around here. We want you to read the passage and think about it. That's what this is for. Then we want you to hear and listen to the Word of God spoken. And then we want you to talk about it in our life application groups, talking about around the Word of God together. So I hope you'll pick this up. It will help you from week to week, just get familiar with the passage as we aim to study that together. This morning I received a phone call from Andy King. His brother-in-law, Mark Baird, passed away last night, kind of unexpectedly. There were some heart complications there at the hospital. They were at the hospital this morning when we talked. His sister, Liz, they live here locally, and so just ask that you would be praying for Liz Baird and Andy and Tammy as they bring the ministry of the Lord to them. They were attenders, I think, at members of Memorial Baptist Church downtown Stanton, and so just be praying for them. The second thing I'd like to do is to report a joyous report, and that is that as I was in the foyer this morning, Rye Wilson and Janine came in, and the first thing that they wanted to tell me is that Jonah trusted Jesus. I said to you last week that one of my prayers this year is that God will give us 12 people who will come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ this year, and that's number two. And so I want to challenge you, urge you to be praying, joining with me in that particular prayer. There are people that God is working in, and we're delighted for that. I asked Janine if she'll just share briefly something that she's been doing. Would you mind doing that real quick?
So it's been really challenging for us parenting Jonah because his heart has been hardened from infancy toward God. And so it's always been a challenge for us. And I've been really thankful for my Bible study ladies. I joined Bible study with Pam Blair in 2020. So thankful for them. But we've been discussing ways of, just trying to get the word into our kids. It was one of our first books or second books, but Rebecca Yoder had shared with me that her, when she was growing up, her mom read scripture to her in the mornings. And so I started doing that, I think, about 2 years ago. I just, while Jonah was eating his breakfast, I started reading scripture to him. And over time, or different things I hear, I've been like adding to it. And so I start off in Deuteronomy and 6:4, I think it is. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And so I read that whole thing, and then I go to Psalms, Proverbs, Isaiah, and then I'm going through the Gospels. So I just finish up with Mark, and then I do some from like 1 Corinthians, and I think I've been doing some in Philippians. But if he eats a bowl of cereal instead of his French toast bites, I can get through like all those verses because the bowl of cereal takes so much longer to eat it. And so in these past 2 years, he's only ever said one thing to me. It's normally just like listening. Like, I feel like it's like drinking from a fire hose, like try to get as much scripture into him as possible. And so, my Bible study has been like, just keep doing it. Like, I'm like, I don't know if it's doing anything at all. But it was a quote that Jesus, it was from Mark, and he quoted something from the Old Testament that I had been reading to him. And he's like, wait, mommy. He's like, can I interrupt you? Jonah's very literal. And I was like, yeah. He's like, do you think Jesus has the entire Old Testament memorized? And I was like, yes, because he's God, you know? And I was just like, oh my gosh, like maybe he is listening. I just want to just encourage you guys to read scripture to your children and be persistent in it. And I'm just so thankful that we got the text. Colin texted us last night at 11:30 and had told us, and so we saw it this morning when we woke up. We were like, oh, praise God, because, I mean, we didn't honestly know. I was just kind of coming to terms with the fact that he may never be a believer, so we're really encouraged in that, so, yeah.
I hope all of us could get through all of those books in the eating of a bowl of cereal. That would be amazing. Thank you for sharing that. I've been saying to you, and I continue to say, that the gospel advances through word, the word of God, and through prayer, nothing else. And so we want to be a church who's focused on that, the word of God and prayer. No other strategies, no other plans, no other programs, just a church that is gathered around the word and gathered around prayer. And so I want to challenge you this evening. We're going to be having our quarterly prayer time. To be here tonight, that we would advance the gospel through prayer. It's not flashy, it's work, but it's with God. And so I want to challenge you, as a people of God, we will see more salvations if we become a people who are pleading with the Lord to cause his word to bear fruit. And so I want to urge you to do that. Those weren't in my notes, but here we go. Many of you responded last week. I mentioned, you know, I said to you last week, we're starting a new series, and we're going to, throughout the spring and summer, we're going to be looking at features of discipleship, and there's two parts. The first part is to look at this topic of making disciples, personal evangelism, the responsibility that the church, the people of God have to be witnesses. And I said to you, that there's a lot of great things about Stand Alliance Church, but one of the things that we struggle with, one of the things that we need to mature in, one of the things that I believe God wants to say to us and God wants to grow us in is this area of witness, this area of being faithful and fruitful in our witness. And so while sermons can't do everything, I want our focus in these next 4 weeks, starting from last week, to be on what does God have to say to us about the topic of being his witnesses. And so last week we covered John chapter 20, and many of you responded. Many of you stood at the invitation that I gave to you. And I want to ask you as we start this morning, how is Jesus answering your prayer? If you happen to be one of those who stood last week saying, I need something from the Lord, how is Jesus already answering your prayer? And as I was thinking about that question, I was reminded that in John chapter 14, Jesus says, ask anything in my name, and it will be done for you. And so often I think that when we come to God, we ask something, and then we kind of move on to other things. Life happens, busyness, this, that, and the other thing. And we begin to just kind of drift away. And I don't know about your experience as parents, but I know that for me, I think often parenting, your children might come to you, Mommy, Daddy, I have this need, I want this thing, whatever, they express something. And there's lots of ways to respond to those requests. And one of the ways to respond to those requests is to kind of wait and see, is this a passing fad that they're asking about, or are they serious about this? Especially when it's something that's important and valuable. And so often parents will just see, is this going to come up again? And I'm going to just wait and see how they do. If it's just something they just mentioned off the cuff and they never bring it up again, then I'm likely not to do much with that. But if they come back to me and ask me, Daddy, I want this, I need that, whatever, then we might, as parents, begin to really pay attention that this is something pressing. And I wonder if the Lord doesn't do that sometimes. Just wait and see. You've asked something of him, those of you who responded. Are you following up with the Lord? Are you asking again, again and again? If you ask in my name, it will be given to you. And so I want to challenge you, if you responded last week, something that God put on your mind, that you continue to go back to him again and again. And we would like to hear the stories of how Jesus is answering those prayers, and I want to challenge you to do that. So last week we tried to think about the question of what do I struggle with and what do I need from the Lord. That was kind of the aim of last week's message. This week I want to bring before us from Matthew 28 the question of what do I believe, and as a result of that belief, what am I willing to give myself to? What do I believe about what Jesus says here in these verses, and then as a result, what will I give myself to? Now, we have a challenge in Matthew 28, 18 through 19, and the challenge is that it's a passage of Scripture that probably many of you in this room are quite familiar with. You've heard these verses before. You've probably heard numerous sermons on these verses, and so there are verses that we're pretty familiar with, and it's hard when you have a passage like this to look at it with fresh eyes, and so that's kind of the challenge before us. To see things that we haven't seen before, to grasp things that we haven't grasped, to feel the weight of the significance that we haven't felt before, to gain the assurance and the confidence that we haven't known before. And so let's just pray and ask God to do that. Lord, would you help us this morning to see things that we haven't seen before in this passage, to grasp things that we haven't grasped before from this passage. From this word, to feel the weight and the significance of things that we haven't felt that weight of before. And Lord, to feel the assurance and the confidence that you give in these verses. Help us, Lord, we pray. Amen. I'd like to meditate on, there's lots of parts of this verse, and as I said, I know you've heard many messages, and so it's a difficult, there's a challenge for me as a pastor to bring to us. What do these verses have that is for us at this time? And so I'd like for us to meditate on the simple word all. Someone has said, all dominates verses 18 through 20 and ties these verses together. All authority, all nations, all things, all days. And so here's the key truth I hope that we can grasp, that just simply this, that the authority and presence of Jesus creates and sustains witness. The authority and presence of Jesus creates and sustains witness. So we're going to spend the majority of our time this morning in this first one, all authority, and then draw just a few implications from the other three that we have. Jesus begins this passage by saying, or this teaching here, as just before he ascends, by saying, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now that is a sweeping claim. In fact, let's just say it to ourselves. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Has that ever hit you? The extent of that statement, it's only about 8 words, but it encompasses all authority in heaven and on earth. And so I want to try to bring up these 4 questions as we think about that. Number one, who has this authority? What authority does he have? Why does Jesus have this authority? And what is he doing with it? And we'll make our way through these 4 as we think about this statement, all authority. First, who has the authority? Has it ever occurred to you, has it ever really hit you that sitting at the highest point of the universe, the one who is running the whole show is a human being? Has that ever struck you? Just think about that for a second. There is a man, a flesh and blood man, ruling, running, ordering the whole world. See, he says, all authority has been given to me. Now, how do we know that it's Jesus? How can we be certain that his claim is, in fact, about him? Well, there's one verse in Acts chapter 17 that is very important for us to be aware of. Acts chapter 17, verse 30, and I'm going to put this up on the screen for you to see. It says, God has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Now there is a whole bunch in that verse, and as I was studying, I found myself wanting to preach a sermon on that verse. But I've refrained, and I just want to show you one thing, and that is this. Notice that in this verse, God has fixed a day in which he will judge the world by what? It doesn't say by Jesus, though that's true. It says by a man. Has that ever hit you? That God plans on judging the whole world at the very end of time, the one to whom everyone will have to give an account is a man. It is a man who will be responsible to settle every account of every person who has lived throughout the ages of time. You yourself will someday find yourself standing before this man to give an account of the life and breath, things that you did while you were granted life on earth. And how do we know that it will be a man? It is one that God has appointed to do this responsibility. And he has given proof to that or assurance of that by doing what? Raising him from the dead. Now, who fits that bill? Who is the person that that verse points to? You see, it disqualifies everybody else, because when you and I and all of our friends and all the people die, what happens? We stay in the grave. But this passage tells us that God has appointed a day and appointed a man by which he will judge the world, and he's given proof to that by raising him from the dead so that you will know it is, in fact, Jesus, as the scriptures testify. Which raises then the question, not only who has this authority, but then secondly, what authority does he have? Look at the verse, Matthew 28, all authority. Now, we should be kind of careful about how we read this verse, all authority. It's tempting for us to think then that somehow after Jesus' death and resurrection, that he gained authority that before he did not have. And that's not exactly what the verse says. Jesus is not necessarily or actually saying that he gained more authority than he had before. Because, think back, what kind of authority did Jesus exhibit prior to his crucifixion? Remember how he said that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, that the Son of Man has authority to heal the sick and to raise the dead, that Jesus exhibited authority over nature, that Jesus exhibited authority over the spiritual realm in the casting out of demons, and that at one point Jesus said of himself, I have authority to lay down my life and I have authority to take it up again. So Jesus exhibited power and authority in the world prior to his crucifixion. So when he says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me, what is he saying? What he's saying is that the reach of his authority is, and all of God's authority, all that the authority that God possesses is now being mediated through him. God the Father has delivered all of his authority. All of the authority of the Trinity is being mediated through Jesus, and that the spheres of this authority now include all of heaven and all of earth. Let me make this somewhat personal to us. He is the one who created you and gave you breath to come into this world. He is the one who says whether you come or go. He is the one who gave to you your talents, gifts, and opportunities. He is the one who supplies you with food and with strength and who sustains you. He is the one who established the times and places in which you would live. He is the one who says whether you live or die. And he does all of that so that somehow we might reach out to him and seek him. He is the man in the fullest sense of the word. Now, that raises then another question. Why does he have this authority? Why Jesus? Why does Jesus receive this authority? And the answer to that in the Bible is very simple. He is the only human being who has ever lived in all of human history, in all of the ages of human history, that has demonstrated that he could handle that kind of authority. You see, in the garden, what was God's design? It was read at Psalm 8, which we didn't plan this morning. In the garden, God created man that he might rule over the sphere of the earth. I give you dominion. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. Man was created together, man and woman created that they might exercise dominion over the world, to rule over the works of God's hands. It was kind of a joint venture between God and man that we would live under God's authority but have dominion over this massive creation that he made. But the man in the garden got the idea that we don't really need God. We can do this on our own. We can be our own masters and lords. We can handle without God. And so he turned away, rebelled, and you and I have participated in that rebellion. Don't you know every day, don't you get up sometimes with find yourself the struggle? I don't want anybody telling me what to do. And so when we rebel against God, ever since that time, there has never been a human being, a candidate, who continually and totally and fully submitted to God's authority in every situation, always doing what God would command. There's never been anyone from the beginning of creation, no human being who has fully, totally submitted to God in every situation doing what God says. No one who has lived under God's authority. And therefore, there was no one who could handle such authority. You know the experience, don't you? When a person gets authority, what often happens? What do they do? How often the authority goes right to the head, and all of a sudden, I got power and influence. We have that saying that he or she, once they, you know, it just went right to their head, and now they're filled with themselves. And of course, that's just with small bits of authority. Imagine authority over the whole world. Until Jesus. Jesus is the God-man, God in flesh, and when he came, what did he do? At every moment, at every place in his life, at every event, at every decision, Jesus submitted to the authority of his Father. Again and again, he says, I only do what my Father tells me. See, he was a man under authority. And at every point, Jesus obeyed. At every point, Jesus followed. At every point and every situation, Jesus trusted. All the way down to the cross. And that's why, amazingly, Paul picks this very theme up in Philippians chapter 2 when he says, and being found in him, found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. See, He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And then the very next word is what? Therefore, because of that, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee would bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And that's why, brothers and sisters, you can trust him. Because when the chips were down, he didn't choose to save his own skin. Rather, he put you first at the cost of his life. And therefore, you know that the one who is sitting at that high place in the heavenly places, ruling over all, can be trusted. Which brings us to this last question. What is Jesus then doing with all of his authority? If all authority in heaven and earth has been given to him, what is he doing with that authority right now? And we might come to some conclusion like this. Well, the world seems to be a mess. It seems to be all kinds of problems. There doesn't seem to be the reality that Jesus would bring. It seems to be just continuing on in violence and sin and death. And I don't really like the way that that Jesus is running the world, if in fact he is running the world. What is he doing with that authority? Right now, what's he up to if he has all that authority? And we said last week from John chapter 20 that Jesus is bringing his shalom into the world and offering his peace to each and every person. So what is he doing with his authority? He is giving time, opportunity for people to hear about his shalom, to turn, to repent, to embrace it, so that they themselves, they individually can experience the shalom that he gives. What is Jesus doing with that authority? He is bringing people into his shalom. He is bringing people to experience his grace, his forgiveness, his new creation. That's what he's doing with his authority, one by one by one. That's what he's up to. You see, if you wanted Jesus just to end all the sin and all of the violence and all of the ugliness and just judge everything, how would he possibly do that? How would he be possibly able to do that work without destroying everything? Because see, sin in the garden got into everyone. It poisoned everybody. And so the only way for him to be able to bring about this work is that if he himself was touched by it and absorbed all of that ugliness into himself, took all of its punishment into himself, which he did on the cross. And then because of that, then to turn around and offer peace, grace, forgiveness to everybody who would believe in the work that he had provided on their behalf. And so what's he doing with his authority? He's extending this message of grace, which then brings up the next question, which is, how is Jesus doing that? How is he doing that? And verse 19 answers that question. He simply says, therefore, go and make disciples. You see, if you have come to receive this grace, if you have come to personally experience the shalom that Jesus gives, if you have embraced his rulership over your life, then now he calls you to be a participant, to join him in this ever-expanding work of extending that shalom to other people, one by one by one by one. God doesn't just save you, but he also commissions you to join him in making disciples. to extend the shalom that he has introduced into this world of brokenness. You know, making disciples is the work of inviting other people to become learners of the Jesus way. And the very, very first step is to discover him as Savior. I'm reminded of a story of a friend of mine, a pastor friend of mine, who received a call from a man by the name of Phil Williams. Phil didn't attend church, wasn't connected directly to the church where this friend of mine was a pastor, but Phil had some loose connections, and so he knew about my friend. And he called the church. He said, "Pastor Gregory, would you come? I'm in the hospital. I don't know how much time I have, but would you come?" Pastor Gregory went to the hospital, and over successive times of meeting with him, several weeks of time going back and meeting with Phil. On one occasion, about a week before Phil died, he put his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and trusted Christ as his Savior as a result of Pastor Gregory going and sharing with him. Pastor Gregory came back on that day when he trusted the Lord Jesus as his Savior. He came back to his church and spoke to one of his colleagues. He says, "Thomas, I've just witnessed a miracle." You see, most of us think about miracles. We think about God doing something out in nature, God doing something powerful in the physical realm. But, oh, friends, Jesus said to his disciples that you will do greater works than I have done. And you know what the greater works are? You know what it takes to bring a dead soul to life? Do you know what it takes to bring a blind, spiritually blind person to see spiritually, to have spiritual eyesight? Do you know what it takes to be able to bring a person from the darkness into the light of God? It took the powers of heaven. It took the death of the Son of God and the power of the Holy Spirit and the working of the Spirit of God in the life of that person. And there is nothing more glorious and more miraculous than that God should do that work in a person and allow you to be a part of that process. Oh, you can't save them. God saves them. But you're a part of it. He is doing that work. Pastor Gregory went there to make a disciple. And he's inviting you and me to be a part of that process. Don't you see? There's nothing greater in life. No other pursuit. No other thing to give your attention or your time or your energy to than joining God in what he's up to. He's bringing shalom into this world, and that will never, ever end. Which brings us to a few small but important implications. Where is Jesus sending this gospel? Where is he wanting his disciples to make disciples? And he answers it with a simple statement: all nations. A lot has been said about the word all nations, the Greek that is there. I just want to draw one application. For these disciples to make disciples of all nations meant going to Gentiles. Were the Gentiles. It meant crossing barriers. It meant going to people that were different. It meant going to people that they wanted to avoid. It meant going to people that previously they had no dealings with. It meant going to people that in some cases they didn't even like and they viewed as their enemies. It meant going to people that they thought didn't deserve anything about God or his word or his will. It meant going to people that they considered to be the dogs of the world. It meant going to people who were near and who were far away. It meant going to people that they considered lost causes. It meant going to people that they thought would never believe. It meant going to people who were different. Do you have any of those people in your life? Making disciples means looking at people through God's eyes and redlining no one. You get that? Oh, how quick we are to redline people. To think they don't deserve it, or to think that they won't respond, or to think that somehow that they're beyond God, or whatever we put there. Making disciples. It's looking at people through God's eyes and redlining no one. And for some in this room, that's going to mean going to family members. For some, it's going to mean going across the hall in your office space. For some, it's going to mean going across the street. For some, it's going to mean going across racial lines or social lines. And for some, maybe it will mean going across oceans. Jesus went across all those lines, and he is still doing it. He's extending the shalom that he purchased to all nations, all peoples, making disciples. And he invites you to join him, to be a part of it. This brings me finally here to all things. We are not only to introduce people to Jesus, but also teach them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Making disciples is teaching. And you know, you might think, well, that's the elder's job or the pastor's job. No. If you are in Christ Jesus, you are involved not only in sharing the gospel, but teaching it as well. You teach through your example. You teach through your words. You teach through your prayers. Janine teaching her child, making a disciple. And then finally, we have a big job to do. It's beyond our ability. It's beyond our capacity. It's beyond our power. It's beyond us. We are speaking about the one who has all authority, and often trying to speak to people who seem impenetrable. What does Jesus have to say about that? One final blessing. What are you going to need to do this work? You and I don't have the strength or the wisdom or the power or the confidence. Many of you admitted, as I also admit, fear often present. How does the verse end? And behold, I am with you when? All days. Always, all days, all situations, I am with you. He doesn't send you out alone, by yourself, in your own power. He goes with you. That reminded me of a little story that I had heard some years ago. There was a missionary worker in one of the islands of Indonesia. This man's name was Einar Michelson, and Einar Michelson had gone to Indonesia in the early 40s. Early part of the work in this particular region, just barely getting started, trying to learn culture and language, and then the Second World War broke out. And because Indonesia was part of the plan for the Japanese to control Southeast Asia, they had invaded this island, and the Japanese were making their way, and there was increasing reports of the fact that they were coming. And Einar tells a story about how just at the last moment that they were told his family had left, wife and children had left and gone back to the States some early days before, and Einar had been told it's time to evacuate. And on the very last day, through a strange set of events, there was one plane that they were able to get on and get out of there. And they could see as they traveled out the Japanese advancements that were coming. They barely made it out of there. Surely they would have been captured, and who knows what his story would have been. And Einar made it to Australia, and he was trying to get passage back to the United States to reunite with his family, and there were no planes that were going. No one was traveling with planes. Only possibility might possibly be a ship, and even that was difficult. And Einar had left his passport back in Indonesia. He had no travel documents, no identification. And so he went down to the consular's office in hopes to be able to put in his request to be able to go, and the man who he spoke to about being able to get travel, air travel back to the United States, just laughed at him and said, nobody is traveling. We can't even get on airplanes, much less you. You're a civilian. You're not ever going to get on that plane. Nevertheless, he submitted his papers, and somehow, by the providence of God, it says, a letter from Colonel Thorpe at Brisbane was received stating that my request for air transportation to the United States had been forwarded to the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces at his advance headquarters. And on September 15th, 1943, I received my travel orders granting me permission to travel by the command of General Douglas MacArthur. And Einar was able to get on that plane. And I want you to know, brothers and sisters, you're not sent by the command of Douglas MacArthur. You are sent by the command of the King of Kings. Amen. But MacArthur didn't travel with Einar. Einar traveled with his documents. But Jesus says, I will be with you. Not only do you have his command, you have his presence as well. Brothers and sisters, may God help us to recognize the significance of what Jesus has given to us, what he's up to, and the fact that he has included you, if you be in Christ Jesus, to join him in this powerful work of bringing his shalom, his new creation, one by one by one into this world. I just want to close this morning. The Word of God never allows us to simply hear it and then walk away. It always calls us to respond. Never to yawn, never to dismiss, never to be indifferent about it, but to respond. And so maybe this morning, somebody here needs to respond with the simple words, I surrender. Maybe you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior. Maybe you have never submitted to his authority. Maybe you have never, you've heard about him, you've sat in services, you've listened, but you yourself know deep down in your heart, you have never embraced the offer of salvation that he gives. You have never submitted to his authority in your life. Maybe today is the day that you would just say to him, Lord, I surrender. I want the grace and the forgiveness and the shalom and the new creation that you have provided. I'm yours. Maybe that's where you are. Maybe there are others here, though, this morning who, you're in a different spot. You have trusted the Lord as your Savior. You've walked with God. But, you know, you've been holding the reins of your life. You've had your hands on your life, on the steering wheel of your life. And today you need to say, Lord, I'm willing to go where you want me to go. I want to be what you're about. I've got people that I've written off, or people I've avoided, or people I've ignored, or people that I look down upon. Lord, change me. I want to surrender. I am yours. Whatever you want to do with me, I'm yours. Either one of those. Maybe just quietly where you are. I'm going to give you a few moments, and then we'll close. You respond however the Lord is speaking to you. Lord, you've heard the prayers of those who have spoken. I simply ask that you be faithful to the word that you spoke, whatever you ask in my name will be given to you. Seal any word of commitment in their heart before you, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
He is exalted.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. And I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name. The King is exalted on high.
As we say every Sunday at the end of the service, if the Lord has spoken to you, or if you are carrying a burden that you want prayer for and with, some of our elders and their wives will be at the front of the sanctuary. They would be delighted to pray with you. Please respond as the Lord is speaking to you. Also, we want to invite you into our fellowship hall. We have some refreshments there as you before you go to your life application groups. If you have not connected with a life application group, we would love to be able to help you do that. Again, we want to be a church that's gathering around the Word of God and discussing it and teaching and encouraging one another to walk in God's way. Would you receive this benediction from the book of Ephesians? Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ask, think, or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forevermore. God's grace be upon you. You're dismissed.